Welcome to the newest E-class car in the world. It's called the most intelligent car in the world, and we'd like to find out just why. Right here on Tech Central. So let's take a ride. Kosao? So William, this is the most intelligent car apparently in the world.
Yes, Mike, karibu to Diti Dobby. And yes, this is the most intelligent car in the world. Launched last year. It's what you call the W213. It's the latest model of the E-Class. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Okay, and what's different? When we talk about E-Class,
yes,
what's different between one E-Class and another E-Class?
Okay, first of all, we'll look at two cars. Or rather, I'll talk about the previous generation and what has been improved. Yeah, that we didn't have before. For the first time in Kenya, we now have a navigation system, mm-hmm. as you can see here, and this is based on Google. So it shows you wherever you're going. It's a real life, or rather,
it's real time.
Real time. Mm-hmm. It maps out branded gas stations. Actually, we notice of late that even the unbranded stations is still able to pick them
out.
Yeah, we have things we call points of interest. Mm-hmm. Points of interest can include banks, ATMs, hotels, you know. Say, for example, you're going to where? Ole Sereni, mm-hmm. and you didn't know where Ole Sereni is. It is possible to map it out here, mm-hmm. and once it picks the location that you're looking for, it also pops out a number, the number for the hotel. Mm-hmm. So it gives you the option to just say call, and it calls.
Oh, wow. And yeah. I'm sure that's an integrated system where you don't have to pick your cell phone.
Yes, you don't have to, because everything is on Bluetooth. Mm-hmm. So you don't have to do that. And again, part of the way we connect the phone, it picks Wi-Fi. And with the Wi-Fi, it means anything that's internet-based, it's able to pick. That's where you can pick things like phone numbers.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So that's the intelligent mapping system which is there, which is more or less using GPS, right?
Yes, the latest state-of-the-art GPS.
Okay. Now, maybe just to see how practically it works, if yes. we wanted to, say, for instance, go to Standard Group right now.
Yes.
Are you able to key it in?
Yes, I'm able to key it in. Mm-hmm. I will just look for a location where I can stop and see whether I can do it either by voice.
Okay.
If not, then we'll see how to do that.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, that is the mapping system. What else does the car have that is impressive, especially technology-wise?
Now, we have the latest technology that's being used in cars right now. And this is something we call Apple CarPlay or Android Auto. Mm-hmm. What it basically means is that the car adapts. Mm-hmm. Give me a second.
So we'll just pull up over here and maybe program where we are going, just to see how this works. Is the map that we are using on the car different from what you have on your phone, or what one has on the phone?
It is exactly the same, only that what you have is the latest. Mm-hmm. It's a state of the art. It is updated.
Okay.
So let me just do that. So we say we do what I...
Just a Standard Group.
Okay.
Maybe you can enter Standard Group on the map.
So I'll try voice. Okay, so it doesn't use voice. What is the building called?
I think it's just Standard Group. Or we can look for anything on Mombasa. We're going on Mombasa Road, right?
Yeah, we're going on Mombasa
Road. Doesn't have. We can put Panari.
Yes. Just try that first, then.
Now it's at the top.
Okay, for
now
it's possible.
Okay. So what we have done is that we've pulled over. We'd like to see how this mapping works. And we'll just pick a place on Mombasa Road, maybe Panari Hotel. And maybe, William, if you can guide us through how to get to Panari Hotel using that map. Let's see how it's going to guide us.
Okay, so Mike, what we do is we get to the menu. I go to destination. Then I say enter destination. Panari.
Then you manually enter the... It's at the top.
So you can
there.
See, yeah, from there we can see a Panari Hotel.
Mm-hmm.
I'll go to where Panari is and I enter.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll say... Select destination. So you calculate the route.
Mm-hmm. I can see it has already given us the distance.
It's already given us the distance.
3.9 kilometers enter. From here.
Now, this is what I was talking about.
Mm-hmm.
If I wanted to call Panari right now, because I don't know where it is.
You've got a phone number there.
Yes, I've got a phone number.
Mm-hmm.
And if my phone was connected via Bluetooth, then it will give me the option of calling.
Okay.
So I'll just start route guidance. And it tells you. So what you'll notice is that as we begin to drive, it shows you the location where we are and the different routes to use.
Mm-hmm.
I can choose to go through South B, I can choose to use Mombasa Road. And let's just see how that works. I think it would be best if we... You see, it makes life so easy for you because you have a full color screen
mm-hmm.
that works with the reversing cameras.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll talk about that because this car comes with something we call a 360 degrees camera.
Okay.
And I'll show you the different locations.
Now I can see on your camera there, it also has a front camera.
Yes, it has a front camera.
Mm-hmm.
It actually comes with what you call a 360 degrees camera.
Mm-hmm.
At the front, we have one camera up here, and you have another one at the bumper.
Okay.
Yeah, on the just about on the bumper, so that we're able to see where we're going.
Take the second exit at the roundabout.
So you see, it continues to show you exactly where you're going.
Uh-huh.
And you know, you have the option of splitting the screen. So if I do want to look at this,
uh-huh.
I can either see it here, or this something I mentioned to you earlier, we have a head-up display. I can actually see the route guidance through here.
On your windscreen?
Yes, on my windscreen.
Okay.
Just that from where the cameras are, I'm not sure that you're able to see, but through the windscreen I can see.
Right now you're able to see what's on the map?
Yes, I can see what's on the map, and I can see the route guidance. It's telling me Lusaka Road, I have about 100 meters ahead, and it's telling me to curve and go that way.
Okay, does it give you an update possibly on traffic and any accidents or any roadworks that may be there?
Yes, it does. If you look at the latest version of Google Maps, you have that option of traffic. Where there's traffic, it will turn red. Where the traffic is moderate, it turns orange. Otherwise, it stays either green or blue.
Okay, and I can see a lot of red right now.
Yes, there's a lot of orange. What I'm seeing around is orange.
Okay.
It means the traffic is moderate. It's there, but it's moving.
Okay. All right, what are the features now that it's guiding us already to go to Panari on Mombasa Road? What are the features that make it intelligent?
Okay, let's put it this way. Now, the cars that we have in the market, no one has done Google Maps. The people who started doing it within our competition, theirs is not this advanced. And even where it is, you know, we are the first ones to do it.
What to do what?
To put the Google navigation in the car.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are those that used to come with the navigation amongst the competition, but those were Garmin. And Garmin only works in certain countries. And it doesn't give you things like traffic updates the way this one would do.
Something interesting I see right now on your screen.
Yes.
What's that?
Now, this has gone on because somebody came too close. Now, you see, with the parking sensors, the others will normally just beep. But this one doesn't beep. Where there's an obstruction, that thing comes up. and the camera goes on.
Ah, okay.
Yes.
I don't know if you managed to get that, but I just saw literally the car being shown there. Does it give you warning as to who's too close, which side there?
Yes, it does. And on top of that, it gives you the visual. And that's why when you talked about the 360 degrees camera, that big an advantage is like now, if we pass near this guy, the camera will go on.
Okay,
it didn't. Means it's not too close to us. In terms of security, that helps a lot because you're able to see where there's danger. Yeah. It could be an animal, it could be an attacker, or it could even be something as simple as, you know, a child too close or something that you didn't see.
Or maybe if you're reversing and there's a child behind you and you can't see them.
Yeah, at least it's able to show you that through the parking sensors.
Okay.
Through the parking sensors and the camera.
Now, one of the things that also has become revolutionary in car technology is using your mobile phone, because statistics do show that quite a number of people lose their lives out of trying to use their cell phone. What integration does this E-Class have when it comes to mobile phone integration?
Okay, Mercedes is about technology. It's about being the best or nothing. Mm. So one of the things that we've done of late, if you have a Samsung S6 or S7, we have something we call Android Auto, or with Apple, any iPhone from iPhone 6, you'll see this, it's called Apple CarPlay. It's a plug and play that I connect, and what it does is it picks the interface, my phone's interface.
Okay.
I want it to come up. So you see the interface on my phone is replicated here.
Oh, it appears right there.
Yeah.
So in case you even have WhatsApp.
Yeah, even WhatsApp. Anything that I want to read, I can read from here. Well, not WhatsApp, but messages.
Okay, oh, that's messages.
The basics, yes. Mm-hmm. There's a part for calling, which I can do by voice using Siri. There's music that I have on the phone. And if, say, I was in a place where there's Wi-Fi, unfortunately, in Kenya, we don't have too many places on the road where you have Wi-Fi. Mm-hmm. But if it did, I can stream music.
Okay.
I have the maps. Yeah, I can be able to use the maps. I can see messages, and then the good thing with this messages thing is that my part is to dictate, because other than those difficult African names, anything else you want, it actually picks.
Okay,
like we can try that. Let's see whether I can send you a text now. Something else you may have noticed, the AC is on. And it was
just
a
moment. Would you like to view your unread messages or create a new one?
Create new one.
To whom should I send your message?
Moiko.
What do you want to say to Moiko?
Hi, Mike.
Your message says, "Hey, Mike, ready to send it?"
Send.
Consider it done.
So, Mike, you'll confirm whether you've received the message?
And I'll tell you that. And yes, I have a message from William saying, "Hey, Mike." Very interesting. So you can actually voice command the whole message. Now, what about if I send you a message? Are you able to retrieve it without jeopardizing your safety?
Yes, we're able to do that. I'm able to do that from the car, and maybe you can try that from your phone.
Okay, so I'm going to send you a message just now.
Yeah.
Let me see what I can write here. And I won't tell you what I'm writing so that you see that it's going to work. All right, and I have written the message. Pressed send.
Yeah, your text has come up.
Okay.
Let's see what it says.
You have a message from Moiko. William is a good driver. Want to reply?
Yes. Okay, you've noticed something again that has happened. I don't know whether you noticed that the camera went on. There was a distraction. The moment that happens, the car will stop, you know, you're not going to continue with what you're doing in terms of messaging, mm-hmm. because the car wants you to change focus and look at the road.
Okay.
Yeah, that's why it's been interrupted. But in case I wanted to reply, I would
have managed messages. To reply.
Yeah, I would have been able to do that.
All right. Yeah. Now, what about making calls? If you wanted to make a call,
yes.
do you have to dial? Because, again, that's what takes your eyes off the road and ends up making it unsafe to make a call while driving.
Okay, in the previous models of the E-Class, we used to have a dial pad, and it is true, you get tempted to remove your eyes from the road, but that is not there anymore. What we are now using in a phone like an iPhone, we have a Siri. So all I have to do is press the home button, call Moiko.
I need to change that again.
Calling Moiko.
There you have it. The call has actually come through.
Yeah.
William calling me. Wow. Interesting.
Yeah.
Okay.
Something else you may have noticed. You know, we are looking at the intelligent bits of this car.
Yes.
If you've noticed, when you're texting or when I'm making calls, when the AC is on, uh-huh. you know, the noise is there. The noise from the AC is there, from the fan. Uh-huh. But the moment you engage the phone, uh-huh. you've noticed that the AC is going low.
Yes, the fan goes down, the sound rather.
The sound goes down, yeah, so that you're able to hear. You don't have to shout, and it cuts out wind noise.
Okay.
Once it's done, then it goes back.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. What else does it have that's intelligent? I can tell from the time we entered. I mean, it's a fairly hot day. I'm not sure what the temperature is outside. I'm sure it must have a way of telling us. But at the same time, it's very cool. Is it one of those that the AC works all round, including the chairs?
You can have that as an option. I'll tell you, like at the front, there's something we call a climatized seat. It's an optional extra that you pay for. So that apart from switching on the AC, because one thing you realize, when you switch on an AC on a hot day and you're putting on a jacket, your front is the only one that gets cool, but your back will sweat. So what comes as an option in the E-Class is a climatized seat that you can switch on a button, you can press a button and the AC comes out through the seat. That means that you can actually drive with your jacket on. Yeah. At the same time, it allows you to enjoy the pleasure of having something like this, a panoramic roof. Yeah. Panoramic meaning a glass sunroof.
Okay.
Yes.
Ah, wonderful.
Yeah.
And of course, I'm sure they're both openable. I can see there are two of them. They both can be opened.
Actually, only one opens.
Uh-huh. The front one.
I can either tilt this upwards, uh-huh. or I can slide it open.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Just shut it. Now, where you're seated, that uh-huh. is called a moonroof. It doesn't open because you're meant to use it at night.
Okay.
It's very nice on a rainy day.
Oh, and also just to see what's happening
outside. Just to see what's happening outside there.
The sky.
But you see, it also helps to create light in the car.
Uh-huh.
Works very well in the cold areas. But again, you see, as we're saying, you can enjoy with your AC.
I'm a little bit
okay. Yeah.
So now we hit the highway, and I'm glad I have my seatbelt. I know I wrote an SMS and said,
what do you do? You can remove the engine.
That hasn't changed.
The speed thing hasn't changed. Now,
yeah.
What about safety measures when it comes to now, when you're on the highway like this, what does it have?
We have something called a cruise control. What I've done is I've set the speed to 60. With certain models of the E-Class, through a radar system. I'm not very sure whether we are using it in Kenya yet, but I know the licenses are slowly being released. The car is able to maintain a distance between you and the car ahead. You know, you can tell the car that you don't want to do more than, you know, you want to maintain a range of 50 meters between you and the next car. Yeah, so through the cruise control, it does that. It's able to pick so that if it gets too close to the other car, if it gets within the 50 meter range, it cuts power.
Yeah.
So we are saying the car ahead of you is the one that determines the speed that you do, depending on what you've set.
Yeah.
Okay. Cruise control also helps you to maintain a certain speed.
Yeah.
I don't know whether we can take the bypass because it's more peaceful.
Okay, yeah, we can slip into the bypass.
Yeah. Mercedes has a reputation for stability. Try this with another car. Try taking this corner. And I'm sure if you've driven on this road before, there's something that you get to feel here. You feel like the car is veering off.
Yes.
Now, part of a Mercedes safety with things like ESP. ESP is an electronic stability program. You don't get to experience some of these things. Yeah, the stability is there. Yeah.
What about the speeds? What speeds can you do without feeling like the car is about to rip apart?
Okay, the speed rating on the E250, the E250 is able to do up to 238 kilometers an hour. Mm-hmm. And it does that effortlessly. Yeah. It's just that we have a speed limit within the country, but you know, if roads are safe and all that, we can do up to 240, I would say.
Comfortably. Okay.
Yeah, whether you're using cruise or... Yeah, it just depends on how good a driver you are.
And on, of course, the safety of the road. And
yes, on the safety.
Whether it's a place where you can test the car.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Suspension?
Suspension, it comes with an independent suspension with wishbones on the front and back. What basically that means is the right comfort is there. Even if you're driving on an uneven road, the car is able to maintain a certain height. Because one thing the Mercedes E-Class will not do is either squat or dive.
What does that mean?
Squatting or diving means you'll never see the nose facing downwards, especially at braking. Uh-huh. You don't see it squatting. That's diving. Squatting
diving. Mm-hmm.
Means if you're carrying goods at the back, you never see the back
lifted. Depressed.
Yeah.
And the front lifted.
Yes, and the front lifted.
Okay. And that is because of the suspension system that it has.
That's because of the suspension system.
Does that help in safety?
Yes, it does. There's one thing I'd like to mention about the suspension. Uh-huh. As opposed to importing a vehicle from Europe, you know, where you have much better roads than we have in the country, ours come with a heavy-duty suspension, meaning the suspension is stiffer than your normal one. Because normally what happens is, if you go on an uneven road, or you find a distraction on the road, where you sort of hit a bump, a car from Europe will normally tend to lose their stability, because it's not stiff enough.
They're not made for that kind of
road. They're not made for that kind of road. They're made for smooth road. But with the ones that we have here, two things have been done. One, the car is raised by means of tropicalizing. And then even that stiffer ride, that also gives you some form of stability. Yeah.
And so, William.
Yes.
One of the things that definitely has to be good in a car,
yes,
for it to be considered intelligent, one of the most intelligent cars,
yes,
is entertainment. What does this car offer in terms of entertainment and in, you know, feeling nice when you're in the car?
Okay. Now, Mercedes sound systems have been known to be some of the best in the world. We call it Mercedes. We don't mention who does it for us, unless you're choosing a brand like Harman Kardon, which is a next level. Or people like Bang & Olufsen, you know, when you're doing that premium thing. But basically, our sound systems are good. Now, we have a radio. We no longer have CD players. Those things have been replaced by things like a hard drive. You know, you can have an 8 GB memory, where it means you stack all your music, whatever it is that you want. You stack it somewhere in the sound system in the car. You have the option of USB ports, where we have two, and there's also a slot for an SD card. Meaning, if say you're driving from here to Mombasa, and you have a 16 GB
mem card,
it is very unlikely that you'll have finished listening to all the music that you wanted to listen to at the time.
Okay.
Then via the phone, via Bluetooth, if you have music in the phone, it is possible to stream music.
Okay.
Yes.
And what about if I wanted to watch a movie? Is there video entertainment?
Well, so far the E-Class is not coming with the rear entertainment, because if it did, then would have screens at the back, which means you're able to watch a video either through the sound system at the front, or rather what you call the infotainment system, mm-hmm, or again the same thing, SD card, Bluetooth, or any external device. But we're hoping that by the end of this year, those things will be available.
Okay. There's something I'd also read about, which was talking about near-field entertainment or communication. What is that all about?
Now, near-field communication comes in two ways. There's something I'll demonstrate later, that if I place your phone, the S6 and S7 Samsung are working with the near-field communication, meaning if I put it on the pad, your phone starts charging immediately. In Kenya, Android Auto is not active, but when it becomes active, it means you'll be able to use your phone wirelessly. You don't need to switch on your Bluetooth. You don't need. There's nothing in the car that registers that, you know, like with a Bluetooth phone that you had paired with the car. It's mainly for convenience.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Then there's also Dynamic Select.
Now, Dynamic Select means you can choose the settings that you want on the engine. I can choose to have comfort, which means the suspension is soft. I don't know whether the camera can get this. I can choose to put...
Let's just put it back on comfort.
Okay.
It shows, it displays there. And what does comfort do? What does that do for me as a passenger?
What comfort does is, when you talk of things like gear ratios, mm-hmm. they are stretched. It means you don't feel the sudden change of gears. And now this car comes with a 9-speed gearbox. You hardly will ever tell when the gears are changing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because like now on the display, it's telling me we're on the 5th gear. But okay. even if I shifted to 6th, you still not
you don't
tell.
Feel.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's what comfort does. It goes easy on the suspension. It goes easy on the steering also.
Okay.
When I move to the next one, which is a Sport, mm-hmm. it stiffens the suspension. And again, the gear ratios change, meaning the gears change in a shorter time, and the throttle response on the engine is also enhanced. Mm-hmm. When you put a Sport Plus, everything changes. Mm-hmm. You see, it's turning red, telling you the gear change is now enhanced, the suspension becomes stiffer. It's the full sports mode, let's put it that way.
So it even gives you a bit more torque power?
Yes, it gives you a bit more torque power.
Okay.
Yes.
Oh, so it has those three. There's comfort,
those three, and then there's individual. Mm-hmm. Now, individual is interesting. I can say I want the engine to be on sports mode. I want the suspension to be on comfort. And I want the steering to be comfort also.
Okay.
That's what that does. So because at times you want the power without necessarily being on sports mode. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. All right, when I was reading about the car, it also talks about Park Pilot. What is that? Maybe we'll demonstrate it, but maybe you can run me through it.
Yes, Park Pilot means the car is able to park itself. It identifies where there's a parking slot. And then through something, I'll show you part of what makes this car intelligent, because we had it in other cars before. But this is the one part where you do not need to do anything. Even the change of gears, the car does itself until the car is well parked.
Wow.
Now, in the new Park Pilot, the car is able to exit also on its own. Mm-hmm. Now, in countries like Germany, where we have something called Mercedes Me, it's a platform by Mercedes, you can also exit or park using your phone. Right now, it's known to work with the iPhone. I know Android may have already come on board. It may have already happened. Yeah, but it's a fully integrated parking system.
Okay.
Yeah.
Then I've noticed that there's some cars which come with what they're calling intelligent lighting.
Yes.
Automatic lighting.
Yes.
Does this car have that, and what does that do exactly?
Yes, this car comes with a multi-beam intelligent lighting. What it basically means is that you leave your lights in the auto, the car does a dim or full on its own, depending on the traffic conditions, depending on who's approaching you, and that works in the night or in dark places. It has a cornering function that just about 20 meters before a roundabout, the car is able to tell the direction you're taking, and the light adjusts accordingly. Yeah.
Okay. And now, for cars that, you know, go to the kind of speeds you are talking about,
yes,
also are well fitted with very advanced aerodynamics.
Yes.
Does this come with that? Just, you know, to give it that smooth feel.
When you talk about aerodynamics, we are talking of how well the car is able to cut through wind. Some of the best achieved what you call coefficient of drag ratings. Most times it's been at 0.29 to 0.3, but this car has a record 0.25. That means when you're driving fast, the stability of the car is not compromised. It holds onto the road very well. It also affects things like fuel consumption, because the more resistance you have towards wind, the more the car consumes.
Right.
Yeah. It basically touches on those fuel consumption and the stability of the car. Uh-huh. Yes.
Finally, I also read something on telematics.
Yes.
And I wasn't quite able to tell what that is all about.
Telematics is combining three things. One is an entertainment system and the telephone system. All of those being integrated into one thing, that they all work together, that none operates independent from the other. So when you talk of telematics and infotainment, we are basically touching the same thing. And that means the sound system also.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good. So generally, of course, one of the things that people would want to know is roughly.
Yes.
Is it a high-end car? Is it a luxury car? Because that, I'm sure, will also impact the price.
Now, the E-Class is termed as an executive executive class. That's what the E actually stands for.
Oh, E is for executive.
Yes, E is for executive. Mm-hmm. So it means if you're a high-end customer, if you're a high net worth customer who does not want to be seen in a big car, mm-hmm. that this car will give you the features and the comfort and everything, the safety that comes with the big cars like the S-Class. Mm-hmm. And that's why you'll notice the shape of this car and the S-Class are exactly the same. The only difference is that the S-Class is a bigger car in terms of the size. Yeah, and the size of the body.
Okay.
And then again, it still adapts to what I'd call a small car. Sorry, I'm trying to look there because of changing lanes. Yeah. So it's middle class to executive. That's where it falls in.
All right, so there's E230, E this, E that, the numbers change.
Yes.
What in the manufacturer, or rather, what's the difference between the different numbers now that you've explained E is for executive?
Yes. Okay, what used to happen previously, something like E spoke about the class, about the executive class. Then the other numbers spoke about the engine capacity. Previously, an E200 was a 2-liter or 2000cc. E250 was a 2.5-liter. E280 was a 2.8-liter, 300, like that. But now, we decided as a Mercedes, we had become too predictable.
Okay. You could almost tell what was coming.
Mm-hmm. We have different types of E. We have the E200, which is a 2-liter. E250, which is now also a 2-liter. And surprisingly, even the 300 is now a 2-liter, all on 4-cylinder. If you want to go to the 6-cylinder, then you have E400, mm-hmm. which comes in a 4MATIC. 4MATIC means intelligent 4-wheel. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then there's the E43, which is now the AMG, the sports version of the E-Class, mm-hmm. on the entry level, and E63 on the high-end level. Mm-hmm. E43 is a 3-liter. E63 is a 5.5-liter. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay.
Those are the engines that are, you know, it falls in the category of the Formula One cars. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right, so let's talk the hard stuff, the price.
Now, in Mercedes, we never do a buffet. We do a la carte.
Okay.
We do a menu. You choose from that menu, and that's what determines the price. But what we've done as a Mercedes, as a DTW, we've had issues before where customers are saying we are not able to get the cars with the kind of extras that they were looking for. So from last year, we decided to do the full thing. Mm-hmm. So if you're buying an E-Class today from a DTW, what you're buying and what you're getting in the UK is exactly the same in terms of the features. So the prices start from around a converted 9.9 million mm-hmm. for an E200. An E250, like the one we're driving right now, will cost you about 11.1. Mm-hmm. An E300 will be about 12.8. Mm-hmm. And then E400 is retailing at about 14 million. Now, wow. With the AMGs, we've not brought in any, but I'm sure you're looking at about 18 to 20 million. Mm-hmm.